Yeah, there's one there on the right now. He's sitting under it.
He's coming across to the left there.
Thanks for the fight, buddy. Nice. Perfect. Look, he's all covered up. Beautiful. Okay, let him rip. Thanks for the fight, buddy.
Here's another full episode that you can watch for free right here at ultimatefishing.tv. And it's another part of our series of looking back to some of our classic episodes. Almost 20 years ago now, and you'll see some of the things we were doing back then that were cutting edge, that have sort of led to the way that we fish today and even capture underwater footage today, which is exactly what we're out here doing right now. So enjoy part two from me when I was a fresh-faced crewman fishing on the Ultimate Lady at the Wanganella Banks.
This week on the Ultimate Fishing Show, we are going to take you on a fishing adventure of a lifetime aboard one of the world's finest sport fishing vessels, the Ultimate Lady. For 10 days, we will be living a fishing dream as we explore the far-off reaches of the North Tasman Sea and fish where no sport fisherman has fished before.
During our long trip out to the Wanganella Banks, while the guys are relaxing inside, the crew's out on deck busily getting the gear prepared. There's hooks that have got to be sharpened, there's lures have got to be pre-rigged, leaders have got to be made up to lengths, knots have got to be tied and checked again, all the lines got to be spooled on the reels, and we've got to prepare a lot of baits. When we're bait fishing, the marlin can eat the baits a lot faster than we can rig them. So we've caught baits previously, got them out of the freezer, and we rig up 20 or 30 baits in advance because once they start feeding, it's mayhem on the deck. So preparation is really important.
Yep, he's sitting right under it. Oh, nice bite.
We're about 1 minute into our fishing at the Wanganella Banks and we're hooked up to a marlin. We'd barely got the gear out, didn't even have things set, and we're hooked up. Welcome to the Wanganellas. It's good to be back.
Like most fishermen, the Ultimate Lady crew has a vested interest in the conservation of marlin, and it's reflected in their tag and release rate of 99%. That means for every 100 marlin caught, 99 are tagged and released. The 1 in 100 fish that is landed is carefully selected. If it doesn't look healthy, it is kept to be eaten. Like all recreational line fishing, the fishermen can make a decision on keeping or releasing the fish. This hook and line method has been proved sustainable for thousands of years. But recently, the commercial longlining industry has stripped the world's oceans of 90% of its large predators, like marlin, tuna, and sharks. Longlines are non-selective and even kill birds, turtles, and sea mammals, all in the name of making a quick buck. And the crazy thing about all of this is that the recreational tag and release fishery generates millions of dollars, and it takes very few fish from the ocean, so it is infinitely sustainable, whereas large-scale commercial fishing of these magnificent fish will not last. The management of this amazing marlin fishery is a real no-brainer. It should be recreational catch only.
Fish,
yeah, what happened there was we had to cut that fish away, you know, crew safety, fisher's safety as well. Started to get a bit angry there, you know, let it go, get her out of the place.
Now I'm just going to run our viewers through our tagging system. You'll notice that when we bring a marlin boat side, we're poking it with a tag pole. And this is the tag that goes into the fish. It's got a nylon plastic end on it that acts as an anchor and locks in underneath the skin, and it trails the streamer behind it. On the streamer we've got a tag number. That same tag number is on the tag card that we fill out for that fish. So we can record the estimated weight of the fish, we can record the day that it's caught and the location. So when the fish with this tag is recaptured again, the person that captures it can measure the fish, record where it was caught, and that way we can learn about where these pelagic fish migrate to and how fast they grow, because not a lot's known about these fish.
For this fish I've got the job as tag man, and as Andy wires the fish I'm just going to talk through exactly what I'm doing. And to put it quite simply, it's just poking a fish with a stick. But one of the most important considerations when doing this is not to injure the fish. We don't want to injure it, of course, because we're going to release it. So we just got to be careful not to poke it in the eye or in the gill plate or anything. But aside from that, we want to get the tag in as quickly as possible and the main body of the fish somewhere, get the hook out and get the fish away quickly. Here comes the fish now. Andy's about to grab the leader. It's just sitting there nicely. As soon as he's in range, I'll take my shot. Missed and got him the second time. Tags in. And there you have it, poking a fish with a stick.
There's one there on the right now, he's sitting under it.
He's coming across to the left there.
One on the left, one on the left, one on the left.
This thing's smoking some strength. I don't know if I'm finding myself in this situation. For the marlin I've been involved in catching, there's only been a handful. I've actually been the angler and wound in. And I can't remember the last time I actually caught a marlin from a chair.
Feels good, I can tell you that much.
Okay, Tom's starting to come back now. The fish has just stopped taking line. My turn to get a little bit back. I've done plenty of coaching people in the chair, but not a lot of doing it myself, so I'm probably really not the authority on fighting big game for some chairs. But one of the sayings that I'd always say to anglers was you've got to have line either coming onto the reel or going off. So you're either getting line back or you're letting the fish take line and work with it. Okay, now it's the fish's turn to take a little bit of line. I just got back most of the 200 metres the fish took on its initial run. It's going to go up on the drag a wee bit while the fish is down deep. See if I can't work it up. Watch and learn, grasshopper.
What's that? What's that? 15 kilos drag.
There or thereabouts, mate.
Boy, your size should be able to handle weight.
Really got to dig it in as Tom comes back, just so I don't give the fish any slack.
Don't get the back and drag off.
No, I know. There we go, give it up a bit now. Just as this fish comes up, the jumper back on the drag a little bit. Okay, give a look at him. Oh, you beauty, I'll get the hook out. Yeah. Thanks for the fight, buddy. Nice fish. Look, he's all coloured up. Beautiful. Okay, let him rip. Thanks for the fight, buddy. Yeah, let him rip.
Beauty, look at him coloured up.
Yeah. Thank you, man. That was a buzz. And here we have the lure we got it on. First time we've run this lure, it's a Williamson Lumo Cavitator. We must have had about 8 or 9 bites on it.
fish have been hot all over it, so there you have it. Been out fishing the film canister, so that's saying something.
You'll get swords. Thank you, Tommy! Thank you, Tomo!
Now the latest cunning plan we've come up with to shoot some innovative new marlin footage is basically when the marlin come up on the lures, we're going to slow the boat down and I'm going to jump overboard with an underwater camera and hopefully I'll be able to film the ensuing feeding frenzy of a marlin attacking the lures. We've seen plenty of it from the surface, we've seen plenty of it on our marlin cam, but I'm really keen to get on the water and just see these things cruising around on the lure spread. So next time we're raising fish, I'm jumping over. And I hope it's soon because it's belting down about 28 degrees here. Oh. And here we go. We're on.
Oh, on the left, too.
He's on the left there.
Well, I didn't quite get a chance to jump in the water then because there were three marlin there. But we hooked all three up, so I'll have to wait till next time.
A little later on in the day, I got my chance to jump in the water. And once I cleared the turbulent wash from the propellers, I noticed a marlin sitting behind a lure. And soon, there was marlin swimming all around me. It was quite a surreal experience being so close to these amazing ocean predators in their own domain. So much so that I often forgot to point the camera in the right direction. Once all of the marlin had faded away into the distance, it dawned on me. I was in the middle of the ocean, 300 nautical miles out to sea, and it was at about this stage I started to think about the great white shark we had seen on this very spot. It's funny how the mind works in moments like these. Marlin have captured the focus of millions of passionate anglers worldwide, and some anglers will fish a lifetime to catch or even see a single marlin. And that is what makes this wonderful marlin wonderland of the Wanganella Banks so special. There are marlin everywhere. Throughout the day we would see marlin feeding in packs on the surface and boiling up baitfish, a phenomenon seldom seen with marlin this big. And high in the tower, Captain Tom would usually spot these bait balls first. First they appear as a dark rippling blob on the surface, but soon marlin become visible, working the perimeter of the ball before they charge in to feed at will on the hapless baitfish. The marlin can be spotted from the surface by their electric blue attack colours. No one is quite sure why the marlin light up like this when they're in attack mode, but it's believed that the purple and blue light that they emit confuses their prey, allowing the marlin to pounce on the bedazzled baitfish. And there is very little that the mackerel can do other than try to be the fish in the middle of the bait ball as they are picked off the edges one by one by the feeding marlin. We knew that the marlin fishing here was nothing short of phenomenal, but we probed a little bit deeper and sent a baited line down to the bottom where it was instantly set upon by large bass. Sea bass are some of the finest eating fish in the ocean, and this lot would feed our entire crew and we would still have some to take home. This location has quite obviously never been touched by man, and the fishing is probably as good as it gets. So we feel extremely privileged to be able to fish here, so we take only a few fish for food, because places like this are a rarity in this day and age, and they need to be fished responsibly so they can be enjoyed for many generations of fishermen to come.
We didn't want the harp hooker fishing to eat into our marlin fishing time too much, so we put on 6 hooks and we caught our 5 harp hooker, so that's the end of our harp hooker fishing for the day. 1 drop, that's all it takes.
While we've been trolling around the edge of the bank here, we've been coming across meatballs. Now, what a meatball is, aside from a tasty Italian dish, is a ball of fish that's been balled up by marlin. And there's a panicking ball, in this case it's mackerel, and we've had them schooling right next to the boat while we've been hooked up. We're just sitting here watching marlin feed on them. And me being one not to just watch them feed and have a go at catching them, I've rigged up my Thorium 30 on my backbone rod with a popper on a bit of 400 pound mono, just a short bit of 400 pound mono, onto a bit of 80 pound shock leader. Now next time we come up to one of these meatballs, or the marlin start coming up in the lures, I'm gonna scoot down and cast this popper out and see if I can't hook a marlin on a popper.
Over the years of fishing, I have seen hundreds of marlin take to the air in spectacular aerial displays. But this time, I could feel every powerful kick of the marlin's tail transmitting down the thin line as it tore away on a blistering run. As the line whipped off my reel at a tremendous rate, I soon realised I was not in control of the situation. By using this light tackle, we had raised the stakes on an already high adrenaline form of fishing. We would need to be at our very best and have some luck on our side if we were to successfully land this marlin.
Right here. Oh, yeah. Oh, marlin meatballs.
There are meatballs and mackerel, there's marlin crashing through them everywhere. I cast my popper into one and wham, got them on. This is going to be a real test for the Shimano Torium and backbone rod, but it's just handling it like a breeze, really. Marlin on poppers.
Just when things were going well and we were getting some line back, some strange vibrations and kicks started to transfer through the line and it began to cause us some concern. We speculated that the line may have become entangled around the marlin, or the marlin was perhaps being attacked by sharks. But then two marlin leapt clear of the surface and it became obvious what had happened. The marlin I had hooked had swum back through the meatball where more marlin were feeding, and my thin line incredibly became tangled up on another marlin. I now had two marlin connected to what was essentially a light bottom fishing rod and reel. This was certainly a dramatic twist I could have done without. I continued in earnest battling two marlin for 20 minutes until the tangled marlin jumped clear, untangled and won its freedom. So I was now back to fighting just one marlin, but we were concerned about the possible damage to the line. Fishing can be thrilling and there are always surprises that pop up when you're out on the water, but this place, this boat and this situation was so incredible I just couldn't believe what was unfolding around me. After about 50 minutes of battle, the marlin began to tire and I drew it near enough for Andy to take a well-placed tag shot.
Oh, nice tag shot, Andy!
With the tag placed in the marlin, the catch was official, but I still had to continue for a further 10 minutes until the marlin could be brought alongside, have the hooks removed, and be released to fight another day.
Hold on to it. Thank you, Tommy.
You have got no idea how exhilarating that was. I've seen literally hundreds of marlin, striped marlin about that size being caught before, but to catch one on my favourite Thorium 30, loaded with 50 pound Cortland braid,
on a 15 kilo backbone rod just added such a whole new dimension to it. It just handled so beautifully. I brought this rod and reel along with maybe the hope of dropping a jig for a kingfish or maybe a bait for some king terakee or something like that, but to add a marlin to the list of dogtooth, tuna, giant trevally, kingfish, bass, harp hooker and snapper that I've caught on this is just incredible. And what a way to end a fantastic trip. It's our last day here and it's probably all we've got time for this week on The Fishing Show. Stay tuned next week for more exciting action.
We hope you enjoyed this classic episode. But if you want to see the latest and greatest stuff from all around the world, you can get it all for free at ultimatefishing.tv or by downloading the Ultimate Fishing app.